Welcome back, geology fans. It is so nice that rational logic allows us to put rock formations into proper order using the rules of relative age dating, and that this ordering then agrees with the radiometric clocks ticking away within them. The heavier radioactive elements require the energies of novas and supernovas to fuse their massive nuclei together. From the exploded star stuff, our solar system and Earth are formed, and so we start with a certain amount of these heavy elements which then decay to their daughter products from there. With uranium-238 having a half-life of 4.468 billion years, and geologists calculating the age of the Earth at 4.56 billion years, that means a little over half of the uranium-238 this planet started with is now gone. This also tells us radioactive decay in the Earth was much greater in the distant past. Radiocarbon is not like these other heavy unstables deep in the Earth. It is a lighter element at the surface with less than the magic number of 26 protons, iron, which is kind of at the bottom of an energy well where heavier things can fission apart down toward iron, or lighter elements can fuse with more ease up to iron. Carbon is lighter with 6 protons, and 99% of it has another 6 neutrons to make up carbon-12. If it has another 8 neutrons, it becomes the unstable carbon-14, which undergoes a beta decay to jump up to nitrogen-14, with a half-life of 5,730 years. So if the Earth just got a set amount of carbon-14, we would have run out of the stuff in about 100,000 years. The thing is, beta decay can go in the opposite direction as well when the nitrogen-14 in the atmosphere, mostly 9 to 15 kilometers up, gets hit by cosmic rays. In this case, high-velocity neutrons, which slam into the nitrogen-14 and eject one of its protons, resulting in a carbon-14. The rate at which cosmic ray thermal neutrons hit nitrogen in the atmosphere varies, though. The main source is from the sun, and solar weather exists, causing variations in output. The output from the sun is also dependent on the sun's overall magnetic field and the Earth's magnetic field. When the sun or the Earth's fields are weak, more cosmic rays and more carbon-14 production, and there's less when the sun or Earth's magnetic fields are strong. And to really complicate the matter, solar flares make these directed outputs which may or may not hit us. One, some wonder if it may have been the largest to ever hit humanity, happened in 774 AD. People in Britain reported a red crucifix in the sky. They were probably seeing an aurora borealis that had come down intensely to lower latitudes. Were an event like this to happen today, it would cause trillions of dollars of damage to overloaded electric grids, shortened out GPS and communication satellites, but as all the lights went dead, you'd be able to see the auroras so much more clearly. So, carbon-14 varies in production, so we speak differently of carbon-14 dating than those other heavy elements used. We don't calculate the age of a sample directly from carbon-14 age, but adjust it for the variations in production over time, and we put out a radiocarbon age from that. How do we correct these? Tree rings. Summer-winter bands in trees from seasonal areas give an annual rhythm that can be used back from the present into the past. We know exactly how old each tree ring is, so we know how to correct the carbon-14 in it. A tree contains rings to its center, but then stops. So we can only count back over the life of this modern tree, right? The thing is, what if an older tree ended its long log life while our modern tree was just starting to grow? We find the pattern at the end of our older tree in the rings of our modern tree. Line them up through stratigraphic correlation, and now we can continue counting back. Run out there and you find an even older tree that overlaps with our center rings of our previously oldest log, and so on. The longest record thus produced is 11,750 years. We know our radiocarbon errors increase beyond the range of our tree record, but an estimate is better than nothing, and counting tree rings back 11,750 years is another thorn in the sides of young Earth creationists who have been such a pariah to my science. The thing is, my PhD was in cave formations, mainly stalagmites, the floor decorations of caves. We cut these things open and polished them, and oh, you know, how beautiful they come out. These pits are due to isotope analysis on the sample, but one of my favorite tasks was to image these stalagmites with a laser confocal microscope, which hits the sample with a UV laser, exciting certain molecules in the stalagmite, revealing these fluorescent bands. Previous studies had revealed the glowing molecules were organic fulvic and humic acids, the smaller and larger organic particles, respectively. Plant matter starts out big collagen, lignin, and other large organic molecules, but when a plant dies, its molecules break into smaller and smaller bits, resulting first in the humic and then the fulvic acids. So, in areas with definite seasons, we see a fall, where leaves drop off the trees and begin to decay beneath the winter snow, but when the snow melts and the ground thaws, the leaves have had time to decay into these organic acids, which now get pulsed, along with the melt groundwater, into the cave and precipitate out with the calcite to form our beautiful stalagmites. So each one of these fluorescent bands represents a spring pulse, and thus a single year. Stalagmites can grow even longer than trees, and continuous records from the present to the past have been taken back hundreds of thousands of years. Even older are the winter-summer bands and ice cores from glaciers, which in the case of one Antarctic core has been taken back 800,000 years. You know, that's not exactly true, as annual band counting only goes back part of that record. And then glaciers start flowing under their own weight, so we can only count the annual bands back so far, and then have to switch to flow models and a third way of getting the absolute date of material, matching with known orbital patterns of the Earth. Later, when we do climate properly, I will discuss what are known as Milankovitch cycles in better detail, but for now, know that the Earth gets tugged at its equatorial bulge by the Sun and the Moon and kicked around by the other planets, especially the gravitational bullies of Jupiter and Saturn. And this is done with predictable regularity, and in turn affects the climate, which in turn affects aspects of ocean sediment cores, lake cores, ice cores, stalagmites, corals, anything which can be an archive of past climate. This is how we ultra-correct the older ice of an ice core, by correlating it to these known orbital patterns, the Milankovitch cycles. And so through this episode, we've seen the techniques beyond radiometric dating through annual band counting of things like tree rings, coral growth rings, growth bands and other bones or shells, lake varves, stalagmite fluorescent bands. Next, we see extension of our time-telling samples through stratigraphic correlation, in which we find overlapping patterns in other deposits when the age of the first deposit is known. And lastly, we use correlation to known orbital patterns, which have been extended back tens of millions of years. And with all these techniques available, we can test one against another. You know, take my stalagmites, which could clearly be dated by band counting, but this example doesn't depend on knowing the exact age of the sample. There are some samples that, like an uncorrelated stalagmite, their age is uncertain, but still have an internal chronometer, clock, which tells us how long it took to form the sample. With stalagmites, we can not only count the bands, we can also absolutely date the sample with uranium-thorium dating. Recall that uranium near the surface goes into solution and doesn't want to be solid, while thorium loves to cling to solids. So as groundwater moves from the surface down, any uranium that converts to thorium will cling to the walls of the fractures the water is moving down. When a drip emerges in the cave, it will only have uranium, which will be forced to precipitate out with a calcite as the stalagmite forms. Any thorium in a clean stalagmite will only come from radioactive decay, and we can absolute date these samples with ease. Turns out that if you take two samples across a stalagmite, look at the differences in the dates, and count those bands between... the difference in ages match. Pretty cool. And so many more than 10,000 years can be represented. But before we finish up dating, let's answer this question. Why do geologists think the Earth is more like 4.56 billion years old? Turns out that using radiometric dating, the oldest rock we've ever found on Earth is the Acasta Gneiss in the Great Slave Lakes area of Canada, and it dates back to 4.055 billion years old. We do have a mineral from Australia, a very resistant zircon grain found in a sandstone which dates to 4.4 billion years old. But none of these are 4.56 billion years, so where does that come from? We know the oldest rock or mineral found is not necessarily the oldest ever formed, and are almost certainly not. We've gone to the moon and brought back rocks approaching that 4.56 billion year age, but not quite. The thing is, every meteorite we ever use radiometric dating on sits right on the isochron lines at 4.56 billion years. Because of the nebular hypothesis, there is every reason to think our planet formed at the same time as these meteorites. And since we found rocks approaching that age, but never older here on Earth and the Moon, we feel confident saying the age for the meteorites is the same age as the Earth, 4.56 billion years old. I bet my ring is older than yours. And with that, we finish the when of our geologic problem. When we come back next time, we will get into the why, finally, as we look into the history of a fundamental theory of geology, plate tectonics. The early years of this idea are the subject of our next episode, here on Earth Explorations.